Hello and welcome to this WealthTrack audio podcast. Our guest is David Nadel. He is Portfolio Manager and Director of International Research at the Royce Funds, pioneers in small cap and mid cap stock mutual funds. And David runs several mutual funds at Royce, including, I'm not going to name them all, but including Royce International Smaller Companies Fund and the Royce International Premier Fund. David, welcome. It is great to have you on WealthTrack.
It's good to be back as well. Thanks for having me.
You recently returned from your third trip to India, and you wrote a white paper on the investment opportunities in India titled What Columbus Missed, Royce Rediscovers India, which you are kind enough to share with us on our website, WealthTrack.com, which we very much appreciate. But first of all of the countries in the world that you could visit and that you do visit, as the head of international research at Royce, why have you visited India three times?
Well, I think the basic reason is that India is kind of too big to ignore. Certainly there has been a valuation story with India in the last couple of years that has made it attractive, particularly in the small cap zone where those companies are trading at very cheap valuations. But, you know, you're dealing with the largest democracy in the world, the third largest country in the world by purchasing power parity. Within a few years, it's going to have 20% of the world's working age population. It's a place where GDP has been expanding at a 6% plus rate for a number of years. It's home to the fastest growing middle class of any of the BRIC countries. And so it's one of a handful of countries that really have sort of a demographic dividend, or sort of a demographic elite country, if that makes sense.
Right. You know, I have been covering India on and off, have done specials on it over the last 30 years, and it is the world's second most populous country after China, and as you said, it's the world's largest democracy. And yet it has lagged, and it still lags far behind China in GDP. It's about, I guess, a third of China's and consumption per capita. And I know one of the stories that I have heard over the years is, you know, India has such great potential, but it never fails to disappoint. What
right.
is the problem with India, and why do you think it's going to be different this time?
Well, I think, you know, India is a very different economy from China. It is, certainly not a command economy as China's is. The level of government involvement in the economy is much smaller. Certainly the capacity to collect revenue is much smaller. Only 3% of Indians pay income taxes, for example. SOEs make up a much smaller part of the aggregate market cap in India than they do in China. So it is a very different picture from that perspective. I mean, I think India's got a lot of challenges. You know, don't get me wrong. The it's one of the few major EM markets that has both a budget deficit and a current account deficit, which is certainly a problem.
Mm-hmm.
I think the good news is both of those are heading in the right direction. The budget deficit is about 5% of GDP now, versus having been about 7% in 12 of the last 15 years. The current account deficit is at a very manageable level now of a little over 1%, although that has historically been much higher. Obviously, they've got very high inflation, which is being managed by their central banker, and sort of being fought by the central bank. So it certainly has its challenges. I mean, bureaucracy is legendary in India. You know, one of the trips that I made over there was many years ago with my wife as part of our honeymoon. We spent almost 2 months in India, and we discovered very early on that if you plan to do, you know, two or three things in a day, you were lucky if one of those things happened, because there's just a real common lack of urgency, and there is, you know, a lot of red tape, and that is a challenge for Indian companies. I think what we've been attracted to is the focus that the companies have, at least the ones that we have selected for the Royce International Smaller Companies Fund, the focus that they have on returns on equity and returns on invested capital, which is an unusual focus for companies in the emerging markets. So I guess part of the answer is it's just such a large market that, and by the way, India has more listed companies than any country in the world, which is an interesting statistic. But,
oh, very. But I mean, how many? It's in the thousands then, clearly.
In the thousands, yeah. And I mean, most of them you wouldn't want to touch with a 10-foot pole. But I think when you research these things heavily and you're on the ground and you meet with them multiple times and you see track records where you know they're growing revenues at a 20% clip for over a decade on average, where they're producing returns on invested capital of 20% plus year on year out, you can get a sense that these are pretty good managers and pretty good businesses. And ultimately, you know, we are picking companies, not countries. And India, as being a very large market, is home to some really interesting companies. So the macro picture is a mixed one. I think from a demographic standpoint, it's extremely exciting. From a standpoint of indebtedness, it's also very exciting. This is a very unlevered consumer. But, you know, from some of those other things I mentioned, those are challenges that are going to be with the Indian economy for probably years to come.
David, before we get to the specifics, companies, which is what Royce does, and you are a value-oriented manager, and we'll talk about that in a second, but the bureaucracy, the bureaucratic red tape is something that I, too, have heard over and over again. And yeah. I know that foreign direct investment, for instance, is down considerably, has been down in the last year, because foreign companies have a very difficult time operating in India as well. So how do the smaller companies overcome the challenges of the bureaucracy, which makes life very difficult for businesses to operate?
It's an interesting question. I think part of the answer is that the smaller companies are more agile and they're more below the radar screen. I mean, I think some of the things that have really been held up, you know, like, for example, Walmart's entry into India, Carrefour's entry, the Vodafone situation, these very high-profile large cap or mega cap issues certainly do get the attention of the Indian government, and the Indian government is you know, well known for dragging its feet on those things. I think a lot of that applies less to the smaller companies. They again are sort of under that radar to a certain extent. You know, the really bureaucratic period in India's history where business and commerce were just totally gummed up was the so-called License Raj period, which, you know, basically lasted for 45 years after Gandhi won independence from the British in 1947. So that was over in, you know, 1991, and that's when the last set of major economic reforms came through, and over the next decade, roughly about 200 million Indians were lifted out of poverty. So this was a period of tremendous growth, which was only really made possible by reducing that bureaucracy. But there's no question in the large cap space, and of course we're small cap investors, but in the mega cap space and in things that are as touchy as, for example, the retail system in India, you know, where these mom and pops thrive, and it frankly is a bit of an antiquated retail system. But you know, the government to a certain extent has an interest in protecting that traditional system and has made things difficult for some of these very large multinational retailers. Again, our companies are just not really dealing with that. We've tried in our strategy with the Royce International Smaller Companies Fund to avoid businesses that have heavy government ties, you know, things where they're dependent on the government for contracts, et cetera, and try to veer towards, you know, more asset-light businesses that operate in a less regulated environment. And again, if you're small cap, I don't know, maybe you're just below the radar.
Mm-hmm.
But
And
yeah,
one last question on the macro picture as well. We just, you know, talked about the bureaucracy. One of the important aspects of investing overseas, as you know firsthand, is the rule of law, transparency. You know, can you trust the audited statements that you're getting? What are the answers to all of those concerns in India? Whereas in China, those are major problems?
Yeah, it's a big question, and it's a difficult question to answer, because I would say that certainly if I put my cynic's cap on, you could say that India has almost an institutionalized level of fibbing or lying when it comes to corporate communications. Now, that does not apply to every company, but I say that as wearing the cynic's hat, because it is very common. In China, you could almost argue that there's an institutionalized level of fraud in certain segments of the economy, and in certainly in a lot of the ADRs that came public in the U.S. turned out to be riven with fraud. So I think it's less severe than it is in China. You can have accounting shenanigans, things bordering on fraud or being actually fraud in any society in the world. I mean, we had plenty of them here in the U.S. They've been in Western Europe and some of the most reputable economies. But I think it's fair to say that corruption, which has dominated the Indian headlines for much of the last 2 years, corporate corruption and sort of crony capitalism, those are issues that are more severe in a place like India than they are in some of the others. And so we really have to be careful with the investments that we make. From an accounting perspective, we're not forensic accountants. So I can't say with perfect confidence that we can trust 100% the accounting figures that we're given. We work with the ones that we're given, that are audited, and that's the same standard that we apply investing in the U.S. Even the smartest and most sophisticated, professional investors can get taken to the cleaners by truly fraudulent accounting. We fortunately have not run into that sort of a situation in India. I think, in part, because we're dealing with companies that have longer track records in areas of the economy that are more transparent, and with management teams that are, better, more transparent management teams.
Tell us what you're finding, and I'm looking at some information that you sent me, that your fifth largest country allocation in the Royce International Small Companies Fund, after Japan, the UK, Hong Kong, and France, is India. So you are making a pretty big bet on Indian companies. What kinds of companies are you finding? And again, our listeners should know that you are a value investor and you are a hands-on investor, so you get to know your companies very well over a period of years, because these are long-term investments.
That's right. So I think what we've really been focused on with the Indian small caps is the consumer story more than anything else. And I think, one of the things that differentiates India from China is the development of its consumer. It's been a much more even development, where rural wealth is really accelerating. I think India, people have a perception of India as being a largely agrarian economy, and at this point, actually, agriculture is only about 17% of GDP. So what has happened in the last couple of decades is land values in rural areas have accelerated rapidly, tenfold to 20-fold in some areas. Rural wages have been growing at a 15-16% clip for several years. So this is creating all kinds of disposable income, where Indians, used to spend a huge portion of their poor Indians or rural Indians used to spend a huge portion of their disposable income on basics like food. They're now spending that on discretionary things like travel, like education, like healthcare, to the extent that preventative healthcare is discretionary. So one of the holdings that we have is a travel company called Thomas Cook India.
Oh, sure.
And, they've been around in the Indian market for 130 years. They're a very well-known brand. They help people arrange travel. They also have a currency exchange business, which is very profitable and very high returns on invested capital. And this is a business which has generated 20% plus returns on invested capital, nice growth for quite a period of time. It's completely independent of the British Thomas Cook. Mm-hmm. In fact, the position that was formerly held by by Thomas Cook England was bought out by Prem Watsa, who of course is considered the Warren Buffett of Canada, basically. And this is Thomas Cook India has become essentially Prem Watsa's vehicle for investing in India, and we're along as a minority shareholder in this investment. So I guess that's one. And you know, one of the things that excites me about that, Consuelo, is that it's at this point less than 1% of Indians travel abroad versus more than 5% of Chinese. So I kind of feel like this growth is headed in one direction.
And let me just ask you, so the Thomas Cook India services Indian tourists, not over foreign tourists who are traveling to India, or where's the growth?
Actually both, but mm-hmm. primarily Indian tourists.
Uh-huh.
So and they are, even own timeshare businesses. And so this is really more of a domestically focused Indian consumer story. Part of the thing that's attracted us to the consumption story in India, you mentioned the, private consumption rates are extremely low. They're actually of the 10 largest economies in the world by population, India has the lowest private consumption rate in the world. It's about $800 a year per capita. The U.S. is at, to give you a sense, is at, $35,000 a year. So, and we look at sort of penetration rates of basic products, things like a car or a laptop, that's less than 5% of Indians have that, or air conditioning. Less than 35% have treated tap water, only a third of Indians have a bank account two thirds have a bank account or electricity. So these are the sort of things, and trying to pick consumer themes that will be the next area of growth, the way, for example, mobile phone penetration expanded in India at an incredibly rapid rate from, virtually nothing to 800 million units in about 10 years.
Amazing.
And so, we're just trying to get in front of the curve. So, on the healthcare front, one of our investments in this fund is IPCA Laboratories.
Could you spell that for me?
IPCA, IPCA. India Paul Charlie Apple.
Mm-hmm.
And so they are largely an exporter, but they're also serving the Indian market anti-malarial medications. They make cardiovascular medications. I think many of your listeners will know that the pharma area is one of the areas of the economy where India has absolutely excelled. I mean, they are world-class pharmaceutical producer. In fact, I think half of the FDA-approved facilities, manufacturing facilities in the world, are located in India. So it's a real area of expertise. Shriram Transport Finance, which I should spell that since it's a strange name, S-H-R-I-R-A-M, Shriram Transport Finance, they finance the used commercial vehicle market. So this is, really low end in the economy. If you think about, the collateral is extremely reliable because this is a, sole proprietor, truck driver, or commercial vehicle owner who needs his vehicle financed. It's a used vehicle, and his collateral is the vehicle. I mean, that's what he relies on for his, for his daily bread. What attracts us to this is, extremely low indebtedness levels in the country. It's a very underbanked segment. They've got an interesting model where they're deeply embedded in the community, so the default rates are extremely low. They're getting very healthy interest, lower actually than their peers, but certainly compliant with regulations, but a very healthy interest rate. And they manage the balance sheet very conservatively. Those are, I guess, some of the examples. AIA Engineering is another one. They are the global number two, I think it is, in the production of chromium bearings that are used in the manufacture of cement and also in mining situations. And they are taking share from the global number one, which is a French company. Again, another company that's been averaging revenue growth at 30%, ROEs at 20% plus for a decade. I mean, these are just, well-managed smaller companies.
So when you look at, all of the small cap companies that you could be investing in all over the world, what are the competitive advantages of these the types of Indian companies that you just mentioned?
Well, I think it depends on the company you're talking about. And in the case of Thomas Cook, I think the brand alone is a competitive advantage. I mean, it would be difficult. There is, you know, a barrier to entry to someone entering that market to have their type of reputation that's been built over, you know, as I mentioned, 130 years. I mean, you have a first-time, almost a first-time consumer of travel services. You know, where are they going to go? I mean, likely they're going to go to a brand that they trust. I think in the case of something like Shriram, it's the very conservative management of a balance sheet. I think you know that Royce is a very balance sheet focused firm. We don't like to add financial leverage to operating leverage, and you know, small companies are kind of fragile enough. So
right.
we don't really like financial leverage very much. So if we're going to invest in a finance oriented company, it better be managed very conservatively, which Shriram is. I think that is a source of competitive advantage. AIA Engineering, I think it's probably well, there is a willingness to do things at a bit of a lower margin, although from my vantage point, we're getting 20% returns on equity, so I'm not concerned the margins are too low. The labor costs certainly are lower than, let's say, a French competitor in this case. You know, French labor is also notoriously inflexible,
mm-hmm.
and Indian labor is not really very inflexible, in fact. So to the extent that a company like that needs to staff up or staff down, they have more leeway.
It's very interesting, David, because again, when I look at the as far as a country allocation, even though you don't invest that way in the Royce International Smaller Companies Fund, as I mentioned before, after, you know, Japan, UK, Hong Kong, France, all of which could be are developed economies and countries, as opposed to emerging market, and India is right up there as number five, and that which says something to me. Is it also a matter of the value of small caps in India at this point versus what the values are of small caps in other countries that you could invest in?
Yeah, I think that's right. And you know, to put it in scale, I mean, it's something like 5 or 6%
right.
of the Royce International Smaller Companies Fund. It is, as you say, it is still a bet, if you will, or it's making a statement. We do feel confident about these businesses. I mean, you know, keep in mind the Indian small caps are trading about 55% below their 2008 high. So there's been an enormous bifurcation in the Indian market where, you know, some of your listeners will be aware that the Sensex 30, which is the index of the 30 largest companies in India, similar to our Dow 30, you know, recently, actually just last Friday, touched a new all-time high, in part because there's more clarity about the upcoming national elections, and there's sort of enthusiasm about that. But it's a real bifurcation between large caps and small caps, and of course we're focused on the small cap space, so we do see a lot of value there. And you know, BRIC equities have underperformed you know, global equities,
yes,
for more than 3 years straight now, which is not a common phenomenon. I mean, it's more likely or more common that BRIC underperforms 1 year and then comes roaring back the next. So you're talking about three straight years. So this has been an interesting period, and I think there definitely is, you know, a bit of a valuation cushion with some of these Indian stocks. Some of those other markets, I mean, Hong Kong, you know, of course, is a bit of a proxy on China. So a lot of those, most of those companies have most of their business in China. So that is another EM representative, I guess, in the top five.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Japan is just a very rich market. I mean, it's such a big market, and there's so many cheap companies. So that's been a nice market for this fund.
So, David Nadel, we will leave it there. It's a fascinating white paper, number one, and I appreciate your sharing it with our Wealth Talk audience. I would highly recommend they read it, What Columbus Missed, Royce Rediscovers India. And you've certainly given us a very good indication of why you are investing in India and the opportunities there. And we so appreciate your being with us.
Well, thanks very much, Consuelo. I always enjoy talking with you. Thanks, God.
Thank you, David.